Hello, everyone. My guest today is Aydin Acar. He's the co-founder and CEO of a company called Influenster, the leading product discovery and reviews platform. He was recently recognized by Entrepreneur as one of the 25 inspiring entrepreneurs under 40 who are creating the next big thing. Aydin, are you ready to take us to the top?
Yep, I'm ready.
All right. Tell us about this next big thing. What's the company doing? How do you make money?
We are the largest product review platform outside of Amazon at the moment. We started back in 2010 with the goals of transforming market research. I was working at a large market research company where market research was inefficient, very expensive, and my business partner was working at a sampling event agency, marketing services company. And that was also almost like a backward, industry where people needed more information about the products that they were seeding. So we came together and we said, why don't we combine the two industries and like build a platform where we can target users for sampling purposes, seed products to them, and then collect a lot of information and then see what brands will say. That was the goal back in 2010, but things have changed. That was also the time when, the social media is becoming much bigger. We started seeding products for some of our clients, and clients were very happy. But they were not just happy about the insights that they were collecting. They were happy about all the buzz that was happening on social media every time we sent products. So the company and the product has started evolving from being like a more market research panel to more of a social media buzz micro influencer network, and past few years a product review platform.
Yep.
We make money by connecting brands with the right type of consumers. We have around 4 million users at the moment.
Those are 4 million brands or 4 million kind of influencers and consumers?
4 million micro influencer consumers. So what we define as micro influencer is like anybody who has some say, some platform where they can share their voices. They have voices, they have opinions about products, and we give them a platform to talk about these.
And how do you make money? Are these brands paying a flat fee, or is it campaign driven, or what?
It's mostly campaign driven. So they come to us every time, especially when they have a product launch. They come to us, they want people to talk about their products, they want people to write reviews, they want to generate buzz, and they still want to collect a lot of insights from these, people before they go to the market fully. So that is, mostly campaign driven that way. We work with probably the largest CPG firms in the country, anyone from Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Estee Lauder, L'Oreal, Goodie,
So how many logos will you have worked with over the past 12 months, and how many campaigns did those guys run all together, would you say?
It's actually funny you ask, because we're just sending our, holiday card to our clients, and that information is there. We have around 200 campaigns. Over 150 logos. We sent over 2 million products in the past 12 months.
Wow.
We generated billions of impressions for these clients. And most of the clients are actually repeat clients. They're very happy with the results, and they come back and they do more stuff.
Well, so yeah, I was just going to ask that. How do you create revenue predictability when this is not a pure play SaaS model? It's campaign driven. I mean, how do you plan things like hiring, marketing spend, et cetera?
That's a good question. Actually, we have some products that we're launching with more like a SaaS kind of product because, like I said, we have the largest product reviews outside of Amazon. So we have around 21 million product reviews on our site. So some of the brands are coming to us and say, okay, how do we get access to these people? How do we get access to these reviews? I want these reviews to live on my site. I want to syndicate those reviews. So we recently, 6 months ago, launched a SaaS product where, it's basically brands subscribe to get those reviews on their site so they get syndicated to other retailers and so on and so forth. So that is only one new product we do. The other product is basically, I think you make a good point about like campaign-based revenue. The way we define it is not necessarily recurring revenue, it's reoccurring revenue because most of our clients are coming back. When you look at like the relationship with L'Oreal, what they were spending last year was basically half of what they spent this year. And the year before, they just started the relationship. And I would say now we're talking about, you know, very healthy seven-digit relationship.
Yeah, I was going to say, so these brands on average, what are they paying you per year or per campaign, whatever you track? I mean, are they all seven-figure relationships?
No, I would say a typical contract size is anywhere between $80,000 to $150,000
annually.
But they're not annual. They're like more like campaign basis. But a lot of clients like L'Oreal, they're very smart. They come and they say, you know, we would like to be an annual kind of contract where the savings can be significant for the brand. So we do those kind of things, and those relationships are seven figures, and obviously not many brands can have that kind of, you know, flexibility or budget.
In terms of size, that's helpful for us to understand your business, right? So with 150 logos on the low side paying 80 grand a year, it's fair to say you guys are north of 12 million in revenue now annually, correct?
Yes, we're in the middle of the year at the moment. Our year end is actually
June, you know,
March 31st. Sorry. So we're like, we just finished eight month. So we have four more months to go, two thirds of the year. And I would say currently we are at $12 million in bookings and around $10, $11 million in revenue. So we're tracking to around $17, $18 million in bookings to around $15, $16 million in revenue.
And what's the growth look like if you take that back? Oh, wait, sorry, hold on. You just said 17 million bookings on 50 million in revenue?
15 million. Because
oh, 15, a 1.5.
1.5. There's some lag in recognizing revenue.
Yep.
So the way we do it is that, you know, we sign a contract and we run it maybe a month after, 2 months after that. But last year, our accrual basis revenue was around just over $10 million. And now we're going to around 15.
Super healthy growth. Now, have you bootstrapped or raised capital?
We bootstrapped initially. First four years, it was friends and family around, all of our savings, all of that. We did a round Series A late 2015. We did it with a strategic partner. We did it with Ebates. They're part of Rakuten, which is a very big player in our space. So that was the Series A that we were hoping, and we are. They had a very good relationship with them. We really like them as.
So how much did they put in?
They put $8 million.
Okay.
And we there's a lot of you know, synergy between the two companies. Currently, it's going really well. We are happy with our partnership.
What did you guys, just so I can round that number out before I move on, what did you guys put in before the $8 million total?
I would say there was around 2012, 2013, some friends and family around like $1 million.
So nine total, you'd say?
Total, I would say, at most.
Yeah.
And obviously, that includes the money that we put ourselves.
Yep. Okay. That's helpful to understand. And obviously, healthy growth rates. What about customer acquisition? What are you spending to acquire these big customers?
I mean, it's all sales team. We have a very, you know, young and dynamic sales team. And some of them are, you know, especially when they're just hired, they're just focusing on like outbound lead generation. We recently built, and this is very recent, just like past quarter, we have a marketing team for inbound lead generation as well. So the customer acquisition for that, I would say, but most of it is like, again, it's our members. People, brands come and see, they, you know, whenever they search their products on Google, they come to our page because we have the largest amount of user generated content out there. And then it leads a lot of inbound inquiries.
Yeah, I get that. But like when you look at your team that's building the platform, I mean, you have to have some idea of either lifetime value or CAC, so you know how aggressive to be, right? What numbers do you use to guide you?
As far as like, you know, our sales, yeah, our marketing budget annually is at the moment at around $500,000.
Okay.
This is mostly B2B. We spend almost nothing for B2C, again, because we acquire new members based on all organic. People talk about, you know, products. But that budget will continue to rise. And like I said, B2B marketing budget is a very new budget. It's just something that we added this year.
So when you spend 500 grand in a year, how many customers will you sign up on that spend typically?
To be honest, we did not. We are in the process of making that ROI calculation. It's so difficult to attribute, you know, what causes what, because this is so new. But I would like to have that, and this is something. Conversation I just had with my marketing director as well.
What do you use? So it's okay if you don't know the numbers, that's fine. You're still experimenting, but like what, because a lot of CEOs are in your exact shoes. They don't, the numbers are tricky to figure out, but what do you use at a guidepost? In other words, if your CAC is a dollar and the lifetime value is $1 million, you should be more aggressive to win those customers. If it's lifetime value is equal to CAC, you're spending way too much. Like how do you get, at least get a guess so you know how aggressive to be?
I mean, at the moment, I understand exactly what you're saying. It's very difficult because we're not spending enough to make like a big kind of big decisions based on that. When I look at the moment, we're like an experimental stage for us to see. You know, we recently started like spending money on like a lot of events, right? The goal is when you go to an event and, you know, when you do exhibit, at least you have, you know, double digit leads that come from that.
You're spending what, 20 grand to sponsor an event?
Yeah. And if you're getting double digits from that, and if you're converting maybe half of that, that is a success as far as I look at that. But it's based on, again, we didn't try so many other things to know that this is good. Maybe we'll have better benchmarks when we try other stuff to see, you know, what works.
Let me shift away from CAC for a second. What do you assume these customers are worth to you over their life at a minimum?
At a minimum, since we work with like very large brands, we look at it as like it's a little bit different, again, as far as like the size of the company and what we should be making from that pie. So when you look at a company like Procter & Gamble and their marketing spend and how much they're spending, you look at that as like, this should be a certain $5 million business for us for this year. And if we need to, obviously, this is as a corporation, a brand, and when you look at brand, like it's obviously different. It is very, very difficult. But
yeah, I know you have cohorts, but like, you know, your first year annual contract value is around 80 grand on average, right? So I'm just trying to assume, like, do you assume at least a 2 month relationship? I mean, sorry, a 2 year or 3 year relationship? What is it?
The ideal situation is at least 3 year relationship.
Got it.
If they're not retaining them for the long term, like, you know, if a client is not coming back after one campaign, we deem that as like a failure. But again, that happens less than 10% of the time. Yeah.
Okay, good. So 80,000 bucks kind of is the minimum spend on these accounts. You have much larger clients, 3 years, that's about 180 grand LTV, right? That's the worst case scenario.
Yeah, but also like keep in mind, the way we built this company is that we started, you know, sending these boxes. And we signed on clients for free. We gave them free trial. We just said include your products in our box, and we're not gonna charge you the initial trial. And now they are spending 7-8 figure numbers. You know, yeah. That is the recipe for our success.
Yeah,
so
I mean,
far.
Look, if that's your recipe, that's very quantifiable though. You have a cost per box. You know how many you have to send to see impact. Like, you know, it takes them 3 years to actually move from seeing all the reviews on your site to asking what the pricing is to close. I mean, that's a very predictable recipe.
Exactly. And the other thing about us is that I think that is another reason, another secret for our success is that our revenue, you know, our marketing, like customer acquisition for members, our marketing budget for that is almost negative because we are making money by sending these boxes, which in turn brings us a lot of new members. So what we make money from is actually making our platform much bigger.
Yeah, no,
so
makes sense.
You don't have to spend any money on that. So that's also like a soft, you know, consequences of these campaigns. It's not, so sometimes when we look at like really prestige brands, we give them really good deals because we know that's going to bring us a lot of new clients and new members.
No, it makes perfect sense. It's a really smartly built marketplace. Last question here before we wrap up. What's your team size?
Currently we have around 65 people.
Okay. 65 folks. Good. And everyone based in New York?
Pretty much everyone I would say around 50 of them are based in New York at the moment. We have an office in Toronto. We have some people there. We have some people in Chicago, and we have some engineers overseas.
Very good. Let's wrap up here with the famous five. Number one, what's your favorite business book?
Well, I really like Quick and Nimble from Adam Bryan, you know, because like I always wanted to create like a very results oriented culture. We can move things quickly. And that was a very good book that I read when I was starting, and I still like it.
Number two, is there a CEO you're following or studying?
I mean, being an immigrant, I always like Andrew Carnegie, because it's a very, very similar story. I came here when I was 20 with very little. And you know, it's difficult, but it makes you more ambitious.
Number three, what's your favorite online tool, Aydin?
Google Analytics. You know, I have to be on it at all times. You know, we grow around 10% month over month, our traffic, since our partnership with Google. And I just want to make sure that that is solid growth that's happening at all times. So I'm always on it.
Number four, how many hours of sleep do you get every night?
I would say around 7-8 hours. I'm enjoying now because my fiance is we're expecting a baby. I know it's not going to be 8 hours a few months from now, but for now, I'm enjoying the 8 hours sleep that I'm getting.
So you'll be married soon. Do you have any other kids already or no? Just the one on the way?
No, just one on the way.
All right. And how old are you?
I am 37.
All right. Last question. Take us back 17 years. What do you wish your 20-year-old self knew?
Just don't worry so much. I worried so much in my 20s for like things that are like now seem super trivial. And if I go back, I would just not do that at all. Because things always find a way working out somehow. Like, just don't worry about things.
There you guys have it from Aydin. Don't worry so much. He launched his company many years ago, Influenster, helping brands connect with people, leaving great reviews on their products. Over 4 million influencers or somebody with a platform signed up, but he's also working with over 150 logos, running almost 200 campaigns annually. They've raised about $9 million, doing about $12 million in revenue each year, running many experiments right now around acquisition and lifetime value, but generally the numbers are working out great with this team of 65 based in New York City. Aydin, thank you for taking us to the top.
Thank you for having me.